If it's your first time at the channel, please subscribe. And if you like the video and leave us a comment, you get entered in a chance to win the Plot & Use Final Dispose. Hey, what's up, everybody? My name is Michael, a.k.a. Rickshaw, and welcome to Worship and Tribute Nerd. I've got Mushmouth tonight, and also, I'm here with Landon.
What's up? How are we doing?
Hello. It's been a long time. I haven't seen you in, like...
probably, like, 5-6 years, maybe?
Yeah, it's been... I don't even fucking know. Like, years...
Yeah.
Years are
I
just,
I think,
like,
that tour was the last time I saw you. Maybe you came out to one of our shows after that or something.
Yeah, I might have seen you at Gas Monkey
then
one
just
time.
Became a shitty friend and just dipped off.
Oh, okay, right. No, you know what it is. I just, you know, you whenever
too
you
good for us. Yeah.
Whenever you become a normal person, you start going, my job's important. I need to do shit for my job.
Yeah, that makes sense. I get it.
And then somebody comes to town and you're like, I think I should be responsible and work at my job.
Yeah. I get it.
And then you end up don't see.
Well, I don't even work when I'm at home, and I live across the street. You remember St. Andrew's Hall in Detroit?
Yes.
I live across the street from that, and people have to pull teeth to get me to come and hang out, and I don't do shit when I'm home except for write and record, so I get it. You have a more legit excuse.
Right.
Yeah.
I also, you know, I kind of like bowed out of partying for the time being. It's been like 1 year.
Nice. Good for you.
And I still drink, and I've went on vacation and had, you know, gotten a little sauced, but I have not blacked out like let's fucking party since last Halloween.
Damn.
So
that's crazy.
Right. Well,
good for you.
I feel a lot better, but then my friends think I'm like, you're different. Bro's different. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, you're also 36, so
yeah, that's true.
Body's slowing down.
Yeah, my body is like, you get in that bed. It's like a constant debate. My whole entire life is like, you should probably get in that bed. I want some free time for myself.
Right.
Get in the fucking bed. You know what I mean?
That makes sense.
Is it still like that out here on tour?
Dude, I'm the biggest, laziest piece of shit when I'm on tour. I just like, I sleep as, I do this thing called time traveling, right?
Yeah.
So I sleep in as long as my body will possibly allow me. And then I kind of just sit up, listen to some songs. And then, like, I don't know, read some articles or something like that. And then by that time, it's like 4. We sound check, play a couple games of Mario Kart with the boys, maybe play a game of poker. And then we play the set, and then I pretty much just fuck off for the rest of the night.
And this is why I miss tour.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like, it's like, pathetically easy.
There's no one
micro. But it gets boring, though.
That's true. Yeah. And even Courtney, I had a conversation with Courtney, and she was talking about how, like, man, I haven't watched this show and I haven't watched that show. And then she goes, it's not like tour where you could lay in your bunk and watch 4 movies in a row.
Yeah. See, but what's weird for me is like on tour, like I don't have motivation to watch TV or shows or catch up. When you think that was like the perfect opportunity to do that.
Right.
I don't know.
There's times where
like doing that.
I wasn't the person that would jump on Wi-Fi immediately and download a bunch of shows. But if somebody had them, they could hand them off to me.
Right.
And I might watch an episode here and there. You know what I mean? But I was definitely... That's why I slowed down on the party now.
Yeah.
Because back then, in the moment, it was fun to party.
Yeah. Our campus slowed down a lot, too.
Yeah.
Like, especially like the... When we were all in our mid-20s, every night was like blackout night. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
But now we're all getting older. I just turned 30, so I can't.
That's when
I can
it
do
starts.
It here and there. But
right.
Yeah.
You're going to start talking to people about, hey, what chiropractor you go to?
Yeah. I just went to my first chiropractor recently.
It was awesome, wasn't it?
Fucking crazy. He fucked me up. He cracked things I didn't know existed.
Exactly.
It was cool.
The one where they twist.
Yeah.
Like, to put your hips in place.
Yeah, they had me lay on this bed that literally just punched my back for a half an hour. That was kind of cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, as far as hangovers go these days, I did 2 days on this tour in a row, and I legitimately thought my liver was about to explode. So
right.
I was like, I can't do it anymore.
Yeah.
Tonight, I'm allowing myself to have a couple, but...
Right, and naturally, too, you know, you feel hungrier whenever your body's all sore.
Yeah.
That's what happens for me.
Same.
So then, so then I'm like, oh, I need to get on the treadmill more.
Exactly.
Because I'm... replacing all that nutrients.
Like I said, even TV and even just working out, stuff like that. I don't know why on tour I don't have motivation for that. When I'm home, I have all the motivation in the world. I'm so excited about life. And then I come out here and I'm just a fucking degenerate. Just fall apart.
Maybe it's the kids stealing stealing pieces of your soul here and there.
That could be it. That could be.
But that's what you came to do.
I guess.
Right?
Yeah.
Right.
Give a little piece away.
Exactly.
I guess every night. Until I'm nothing with this fucking.
That means you're a real artist, dude. Come
I guess.
On. You give away your soul until there's nothing fucking
my
left.
Liver at this point probably looks like a microwaved football.
Hey, at least you could throw it around, you know, with the old kid.
That's right.
Hey, do you have a kid?
No.
Okay.
No kids.
No kids yet for me.
Yeah. I'm not responsible enough yet. I'll get there, but. I don't want to. Yeah. Also, I don't want to have a kid while I'm touring.
Right.
I don't think. Maybe.
So, what's the plot? And you've been up to?
Too much touring.
Too much.
Well, this year it's been a little slower. But last year, I think we toured 9 months out of the year. We're doing like there was one. We did a full U.S. with We Came as Romans. Then we did all of Australia. Then we did a lot of Europe. So we were gone for like 2.5 months. And when I got home from that, I thought I needed to see a therapist and shit. It broke my brain completely.
I just did a video with We Came as Romans.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, those dudes are the best.
They are such chill dudes.
Yeah, they're awesome. Very, very good guys.
Yeah, and...
We're talking about partying. Those dudes still go just as hard as they did when they were 21, 20.
Dude, I just remember being like, these damn kids are so obnoxious. And then halfway through tour, I was like, I love these kids, you know.
They're great.
Even though I'm not even that much older, honestly.
Yeah.
But...
Yeah, those dudes, they're built out of something different.
Yeah.
I don't get it. It's wild. Yeah, I can't keep up.
They're the next step in evolution, man.
I guess so. I hope so. Give my kid some hope.
It's all the beer and the drinking. And the people that can live through it, they get mutant powers.
Hopefully I've abused my liver so much that my kid gets the strongest, like, fucking steel tank of a liver.
Right.
But I don't think that's how genetics work, sadly.
Do you believe in mutants?
No.
No.
Not yet.
Okay.
I believe in very bizarre people that resemble mutants.
That's true. But you don't think that there is real mutants that could lift beyond human capabilities or
maybe
fly?
Not yet, but it could. It could be in the foreseeable future. You never know.
You never know. I mean, magicians.
Yeah.
They're crazy already.
They are. It's crazy. David Blaine. He's real. It's nuts. I still can't believe he's real sometimes.
Dude, I don't know.
2019, I'm still baffled by that guy.
My brother used to say, do you really think that maybe he's like a demon or something?
That's what my dad was worried about growing up. Because like, he was like this big Christian guy. And I was super into David Blaine. He was on the fence about it. He's like, I don't know, he's really good, but he's something's off about this guy. I was like, Dad, shut up. He's just good at what he does. Pussy.
Dude, we went to the Magic Castle in Hollywood.
Oh, yeah?
A few months ago. You ever heard of that place?
No. Is that in Disneyland?
No. So it's like downtown Hollywood, and it's like this big house on the hill, and it looks like a haunted house or whatever, but it says the Magic Castle, like real big.
Yeah.
So it's like one of those places everybody like hears about. Mm. So it's like a bar / restaurant, and you pay for a ticket, and it's kind of expensive, you know, but you have to be invited.
Mm-hmm.
You have to find people that are members, and you have to, it's very exclusive.
That's cool.
And then you pay for a ticket, and if you bail... then you have to pay a fine.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you go and you pay for a ticket, you're obligated to eat dinner, which is like $50 per, you know, plate, you know, something like that. Anyways, but there's a bunch of different rooms and they all do magic. And you hang out and drink and
I would
watch magic all night.
I'd be way into that for sure. Would you take me on a date there? I'll fly down. You fly me down. Pay for it.
Well, you know, I've had a lot of guy friends hitting on me lately. You know what I'm saying?
I believe it. That sounds dope, though. Yeah.
Blushing, dude. Anyways, so you're into magic.
Yes.
So let's get to the nerdy part of this. You know, what makes you tick as a nerdy person?
I don't know. I guess it's all subjective, obviously.
Okay.
But, I mean, we get crazy on some Mario Kart in this camp.
Oh, yeah.
To the point where it's like, it gets scary sometimes. Like, people's feelings get hurt and stuff.
I have, you know, I've been a part of that in the past.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Me and my brother, he's full Thai. You know, he would get into Mario Kart pretty heavily, and it felt like I was like... you know, watching Tokyo Drift, you know, with him, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Because he was like, brace me, motherfucker, you know. Yeah.
Was he playing
like,
online
Red Shell,
shit?
Bitch.
Yeah.
No, that was like, you know, N64 days.
Oh, right.
Like me
yeah.
and him,
yeah.
we're, he's only playing
well, it's
me.
Online now. Yeah, you can yeah. race people all around the world.
Right.
Which is
does
crazy.
It get pretty...
Dude, it's mind-blowing. I played for like an hour today trying to just get one win, and I got second. That was the best I got. These little Japanese kids are fucking... They're on... They found a new yeah. button that no one else knows about.
I am usually pretty good at a lot of games. Like, yeah. you know, like, let's just say Mario Kart. You know, I'm pretty good. Mm-hmm. Mortal Kombat, like, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But then when I get online and play, I'm like,
you just feel like
fuck
such a
these
loser.
Kids.
Yeah. Dude, some of them, man, it's nuts. Like, you watch... Like, have you ever watched a Fortnite video or anything like that?
I mean, you know...
Those
watch
people are
people
doing some... crazy inhuman
elite.
Shit yeah
elite
shit a human being should not be capable of doing in the allotted time that you're given.
Right.
It's wild.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Pop
Mario
out.
Kart and we play some Mario Party and we do some Fortnite still.
Yeah. Dude, Mario Party.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the video of the dude just getting destroyed? Like he's like winning and then he lands on one of those like dice rolls.
Yeah, that fucks him
yeah.
up.
Yeah.
No, I don't
like,
think so.
And they were like, no, if it rolls this, he's fucked. And it rolled it. And
yeah.
they're like, oh no, if it rolls this, then he's done. And it rolled it. Like, you know what I mean? Like, the whole room was just like, oh.
That game's,
you know.
That game's so much chance, though. You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, it is.
You could just literally be mashing buttons the entire
right.
time and you could win.
A dog could play.
Yeah, a dog could play and possibly beat you.
Right.
Yeah.
But that would be tight. I would like to see that.
Yeah.
I would like to root for my dog to win.
Same. That's pretty, yeah, those are pretty much the only games we've been that into, but like that consumes a lot more time than you would expect.
Right. Yeah. yeah.
Especially the Mario Kart, because we're all so competitive. We start doing the time trials now where you're racing yourself to
yeah.
beat your own best time. That's when I started to realize, like, okay, I'm 30. I need to get my shit.
Right.
My priorities.
Does it show
straight.
You the ghost image on the screen?
Yeah.
Oh, that
so I'm
makes
just like
even...
for hours just playing against myself, trying to like.
Right.
It's pretty pathetic. I do it. It's part of me.
Yeah. There's something about this. There's like a big doppelganger thing going down in Hollywood. You know, have mm-hmm. you noticed that recently? Mm-hmm. You know, like they're doing shows and movies where it's like
doppelganger
about
shows.
About your clone or your doppelganger. I'm seeing it with Will Smith and some other shit. Uh-huh. But, anyways, yeah. That's why. You've
that's
seen
crazy.
It everywhere.
It is.
It's the year of the doppelganger, dude.
I saw, we used to have a good doppelganger for Josh.
Yeah.
And every time he would do something stupid, we'd like send that picture to him of him like doing
oh,
something
right.
stupid. We're
yeah.
like, Josh, remember this time you did this?
Yeah.
He hated it so much.
I wrestled a bear once. That was a big game to find someone that looked like you. And
me
call you out? No, like, oh, like just
I was
anyone.
About to say, well, glad
anyone,
you're talking
not
about
you.
This 6 years later. Turned
no,
into a
no,
weird game.
No, like each other. Mm. You know what I mean? Like it would be like Mikey, look at you, and then you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And it would be like some little short, you know, brown dude.
Yeah,
I don't know. It's one of those things, or like you know, a big fat lady in a wheelchair. You're like, yo, Krista, what's
yeah.
up? What are you doing?
That's sick.
You know what I mean? One of
yeah.
those humanity hater games.
That's
you know
cool.
I
back that.
Yeah.
You got to make up games.
Yeah. Yeah. We like that's what gets you through especially the first year of being on tour.
Oh, I mean, we still have to create little games all the time to keep ourselves occupied. We used to play this game called Inspection.
What's that?
So it's kind of like tag, but with a flashlight. But like whoever's the inspector, you call inspection. Everyone has to line up, and you have to show your asshole, bend over. So whoever has the dirtiest ass becomes the new inspector. So
right.
You kind of want the dirtiest ass.
This is
it's not
this
a very
a cool
respectable game.
Game.
I think I'm gonna leave that in my 20s. I haven't played it once in my 30s, but. It was a good one. Yeah.
In my old band, before I was ever in Iwaba, shout out, Surrounded by Monsters, but like there used to be a game where if you called the passenger person out, mm. you called out the blowjob game, mm. right? Have you ever done that?
No.
So when you're passing a car, you call out the passenger driver or the
sounds
passenger
like a scary
seat.
Game.
You're like, yo, blowjob. And so then the passenger has to act like he's giving the driver a blowjob.
Okay.
For the car passing by. So you have to
that's good.
You're trying
like
to get
that.
Their attention, right?
Yeah.
yeah.
That's great.
So that's the game. That's the whole thing.
We used to play this one where you Everyone in the van would select when you're going through a toll booth and you have to talk to the person for a second, come up with three words. And you have to incorporate those random three words in a conversation with that person.
Right.
Oh, man, it got brutal, as I'm sure you can expect.
That sounds like
very interesting.
Game.
Yeah.
There's a lot of dumb games you make up. Dude, you're just like, I think at the beginning, especially for me anyways, like it was like, I can't believe that we're going to be in the van this much. For a long time.
Yeah.
So then you start making up your dumb games.
We gamble a lot too now. That's our big thing. We play a lot of poker and we'll just like gamble on. In the morning, we'll like assess everyone's different pee bottles and try to see whose is whose. Try to match it to the person. So we don't have a bathroom in this rig. So.
Right.
Well, these are, we call these bathrooms. These are our bathrooms.
Tight.
We literally call. And if it's a full bottle of water, we call it a future bathroom. Yeah. Pass me a future bathroom.
Right.
Yeah, that's my favorite joke
sense,
of this tour.
Honestly.
Yeah, it does. Were you guys all into pissing in bottles?
You know,
oh, you had a lady, so you probably didn't.
If I had to do it, I would. Like if it was an emergency, you know what I mean. But Mikey was definitely. They started calling him Peebles because he just pee bottles. You know what I mean. So there was a point in time where we were off tour and they found pee bottles in his room. And we were like, you got a problem.
I'm guilty of that.
You
I'm
are?
So guilty of that. Dude, I used to live in a house where the whole upstairs didn't have a bathroom. The only one was downstairs. My studio was up there.
Right.
So it got bad. I don't even want to get into that. That was embarrassing. But yeah, at one point there was like 10 piss bottles up there.
Gotcha.
It's pretty embarrassing.
It's all good.
Yeah. That was life. That was life back then. This is life now. So.
Yeah. You're calling your own shots, you know what
exactly.
I mean? Like, we're all adults.
I do love peeing in bottles, though. I really enjoy peeing outside. That's my favorite, but got to be really careful about that these days. That's pretty taboo. Last tour, we got into shitting outside. Like, you got to be really careful with that. Then we got into, like, shitting on each other's shits to try to build, like...
Wow. You guys...
We're on some weird, weird stuff.
Right. It's like camp, though. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's a different kind of...
That is like a teenage camp.
Yeah. Like
church
Boy
camp.
Scouts or something. Like, I bet you won't poop in the woods.
Yeah. You won't poop on my poop.
I'll bet you right now.
You poop on my poop.
Yeah. Bet I will.
Soon enough, you got a poop sculpture.
Pretty soon you got to light on fire, too.
Yeah. That's the next step. Yeah.
Right. If it's a waste if you don't. I'm just saying.
Amen.
So where were we with the nerdy? You said, you were talking about some Mario Kart.
Yeah.
You got anything else besides games? You got some like, what's favorite movies, favorite?
Oh, shit. Well, I just finished Breaking Bad again.
Oh, okay.
Which was sick because the movie came out. Did you see that?
El Camino.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you like it?
Yeah, it was awesome.
I loved it.
Oh, my God.
A bunch
God.
Of my friends thought it was bad. I loved
what?
It. Yeah.
I don't know. It took me back to that feeling, that Breaking Bad, like that tension.
To see something brand new in that world was just so cool.
And it took its time, too.
Yeah.
You know,
I never really watched much of Better Call Saul. But
honestly,
I heard it's sick. But
dude, honestly, it starts pretty slow, but you have to just, tough with it.
Yeah.
Because, like, it becomes so good.
Yeah.
And
it starts to incorporate more.
When you take care of a baby, it could be boring.
Yeah.
But when it grows.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's when you get the feels. You know
that
what
is
mean?
Very true. I need to give that a shot.
But, yeah. It's like the whole progression of him even becoming like a bad person already.
Yeah.
He was like, he's like pretty damn straight, you know, at the beginning
at
of the show. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and it gets pretty awesome.
Is that still going?
Yeah, I think
so. That's good to hear.
Yeah, it is.
I'll get into that for sure. Other than that. That was pretty much like the only thing I watched on this tour. I don't really listen to music on tour.
Yeah.
Or really that much at home anymore.
Really?
Kind of more just listen to podcasts and watch random YouTube stuff here and there.
Right.
But, yeah.
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
I think the only time I really listen to music is in the car.
Yeah.
So like when I drive to work, I'm like, let's do it. You know,
well,
I mean?
Live in the city now, so I like barely drive anywhere.
Right.
Yeah. So my music listening is very... minimal.
Or at the gym, if I go
yeah,
to the gym.
Yeah, at the gym. I do, that's probably the one time I do listen to music. Every time. But, yeah.
What are you jamming? What are you jamming at the gym?
I've been super into this chick, King Princess. Have you ever heard of her?
Mm-mm.
So sick. Like, amazing.
Right.
She's like this lesbian pop artist that just sings about that, basically, just chicks. And
right.
Yeah, I don't know. It's really unique. It's I think she's about to be massive. She's kind of in that same realm as, like, Billie Eilish, but more...
Right.
I don't know. There's a little edgier, maybe.
I don't know. With me, like, I could get into some of the, like, you bring up Billie Eilish especially. It's like if everyone else didn't tell me, I might.
Yeah.
I would probably like it.
I was one of the few that, like, kind of got into it a little bit before the curve, the Billie Eilish thing. And I still do like her music a lot. But, yeah, now I hear it so much. I'm like, damn, I missed when she was just, like, that gem. You know what I mean? That was about to pop. That's where I feel like King Princess is right now.
Nice.
Yeah, just about to pop. But yeah, she's got a new record coming out in a few days. I'm really stoked about that. Then I'll start jamming new music all the time, or her music nonstop. Yeah. I'm stoked. Very stoked. But yeah, other than that, I really don't think there's been much. I mean, I always listen to my friends' bands when they come out with new singles and stuff like that.
I usually do too.
Try to support the homies, but
yeah.
Yeah, other than that, I don't know. It's rare that I come across anything I'm like super stoked about, you know? So when I find something I like, I pretty much only listen to that for a long time. So,
have you ever like toured with a band and you like kind of aren't really into their music, but then you get to know them and then you watch them and you feel like dad or something? You're like, I'm so proud of these guys.
Yeah, like, I feel like almost every band that I've toured with that became friends with, whether I like their music genuinely or not, like I can listen to it and find things I like about it. You know what I mean?
You're like, well, I remember Oceana when we were first about to tour with them. I was like, they're gonna hate.
Oh, we toured with them with you,
right? Yeah. And I was like, they're gonna hate us and they're gonna beat us up. You know, it was like one of those.
They're the nicest dudes in the world.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, they're so sweet. Same. Yeah, that was actually, I felt the exact same way before we toured with them. I was like, I hate that like fast shit. Like, and even you guys, I was like, I don't get it. Like, it made no sense. And then I toured with all you guys. I was like, okay, I like. You know what I mean? I found things that I liked about it.
Right. Yeah. ADD.
Yeah. Your band was very ADD. Very crazy.
Right.
It was cool, though. Yeah.
I had fun.
Yeah.
I miss it.
Yeah.
But I also don't. You know what I mean?
I see. I never miss tour when I'm off tour.
Right.
You know what I mean? But once I'm back on, I'm like, this is cool. More than anything, I think just the aspect of hanging out with the guys and catching up with them, because we're all best friends. You know what I mean? We don't really see each other off tour because we all live pretty decently far away from each other now, so that's kind of our time to reconnect. And but then by the end of the tour, you're like, fuck you, dude, like I can't wait to not see you for a few months. Not really, but kind of.
I used to remember, like, every time a run would get too long, you'd start being like, man, I'm depressed.
That's me right now.
And really?
Yeah. We're like, dude, 2.5 weeks in, I'm like, God, fucking kill me.
Yeah, but then you'd wish, I wish I had some time off. You get that time off, and after a couple weeks, you're like, I'm depressed.
Yeah.
I don't have nothing to do. I have no
drive. Yeah.
I have nothing to do.
See, I definitely used to feel that way, but these days when I'm home, I feel like I'm
new man.
Yeah, like I'm on a new thing every time. I have a new thing to look forward to.
You turn into your doppelganger.
Yeah. It's something I'm actively trying to progress in, is getting better about managing my time more efficiently while being on tour, you know, because it's easy to fall into that, like, just get the day over with, you know what I mean?
Right.
So I've been trying more so lately to incorporate healthy, positive decision-making into my everyday life, you know, so.
There's something about having a schedule that eventually becomes really depressing.
Kind of, yeah, I guess.
And then all of a sudden you do something different that is like no schedule, it like refreshes you up, and you're like, oh, time has slowed down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
The schedule of being on tour, though, which is something I feel like isn't talked about that much, is it's very much, it's the same every day, like load in. It's, at least on a tour like this, load in is the same every day. You pretty much play at the same time every day. So like, but you know when your free time is, and that free time is almost like, oh my God, can we get to the next part, like where I have something to do, you know?
Yeah.
Between the time of you playing versus the time of you loading out, and you know what I mean? Like you almost look forward to those moments where you need something to do.
But, like you want to play Pogs, dude?
Yeah.
At 5:30?
Yeah. Yeah. But we have it.
That sounds tight.
Yeah, the whole like first 2 weeks of this tour, we almost had like a schedule. Like, okay, after load in, we play 3 rounds of Mario Kart, then we play poker, then we gamble with CeeLo for a little bit, and then we sound check. And then
you ever go gamble in a casino?
Yeah, we have on this tour a few times.
I was a dealer for a long time.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
that's sick.
So,
oh yeah, you said blackjack, right?
Yeah, it sucked, but
I'm sure you saw some cool, crazy
knowing
things
how happen. To like learning to do it and becoming good at it and. Living it for a while is like pretty fun.
Yeah.
But then
did you ever have people like almost resent you for their bad hands.
Oh
that
yeah, that's
dealt.
the hardest
in general. A lot of like the hardcore addicted people are degenerates, right?
The hardest part about being a dealer is just everyone dogging on you. Like it's your choice.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. They brought their money to you
to lose,
and they were like, "You're gonna make me win." And then when that doesn't happen, they're like, "Fucking dealer."
Yeah, you're the worst enemy.
Yeah, yeah. So
yeah, I wouldn't want that stress on me.
And you know, I dealt baccarat.
What is it?
You ever play baccarat?
Uh-uh.
Okay, so baccarat is a Chinese game, but everyone gets all scared, especially, you know, white folks or whatever, and they get scared because they see all these Asian symbols on the table, and they see a bunch of Asian people fucking smoking cigarettes, like being like,
so like, oh, I don't stand a chance here.
So, all it is there's a player side and there's a banker side, and you pull out, the dealer pulls out cards. Mm. And the closest thing to nine wins.
Okay.
That is the vaguest way possible without getting into confusing rules and shit.
Which I'm sure there are plenty of.
To teach you how to play. Right. Yeah. Anyways, so it's literally 50-50 chance. You just have to bet on which side you want. And then sometimes there's a tie and you keep your money.
Mm.
So it's so stupid that most people are scared to play it because it's that simple.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, the thing is about those players is, like, they're just like, you know, I'm half Asian and, you know.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, I'm cool. Half Thai.
Oh, cool.
So, and you get a lot of Thai.
Half Asian, half Thai?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Or no, half, oh, I'm, so, no, I'm half oh. Thai, half white.
Oh, okay.
That's what I am.
Gotcha.
So anyways, whenever, you know, when you're at those tables, they're just like, they could be brutal, but they don't realize it. That's just the way they are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're not trying to disrespect you. They're just like, Floor, give me my fucking money. And you're like, you know, where's my money? And they're like, hey, calm down. Like,
yeah.
They're just brutal. You know what I mean? They could be unfiltered.
Mm.
So there's times where they're just like, fucking dealer. They're like, fucking dealer. Take my fucking money. You know, stuff like that. And you're just like, hey, you chose to come up here, you know.
Yeah.
And
throw your money away.
Get lost. Get off my table. Mm. Ugh, fucking dealer. You know what I mean?
This one. Did you have to ever have anyone kicked out?
I mean, it happens every now and then, you know.
That would suck. It's, yeah,
it's always pretty fun. Yeah. It's just, you know, no one has respect for you because they're just there to fucking throw their money around and like, you know, you should kiss their ass. That's what they think.
That's why they need to have robot dealers, so that they can just throw their drink in the robot's face, self cleans itself, and then everyone's happy.
But then, you know, that starts happening, and then the robots become sentient, and they realize that. It's not equal rights. You know what I'm saying?
True.
That's what's going to happen.
It's scary. Scary stuff.
It is scary to think about.
But. I actually, back to this is off subject. I did see It too today.
Oh, really?
Have you seen that?
Yes, I have.
I would like to hear your thoughts.
Okay. Let's start right at the beginning. I liked part two better than part one.
Really?
Yes.
You might be the first person I've heard say that.
Okay. Here's my reason. So in the book... It happens, the story progresses jumping from young to old.
Yeah.
It actually, I think the very first is there, it shows them old, right? And then they go to flashbacks about when they were kids. So the story goes like that, back and forth, back and forth.
Yeah.
So whenever I watched it, that's what I wanted. That's what I needed.
You wanted the adults.
I needed the adults to tell me the story.
Mm-hmm.
And then you could tell it was a thing where they were like, let's do part one. And if it goes well, maybe we'll do part two. You know what I mean? And I didn't like that. It wasn't all just planned at once.
Yeah.
It could have been from the beginning. Mm-hmm. If they would have just done it, the structure, like the book, I think that's what would have satisfied me more.
Yeah.
But as far as the ending, I still enjoyed it, but I could see why somebody might not like it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like Stephen King has like literally been... You know,
he's in it too, which I thought that part I thought was cool.
Yeah, but I mean, let's just talk about every Stephen King book. The endings are always like pretty cool, but then it's just kind of like it was the journey with lots of Stephen King books. It's not about the destination.
That's true.
Which sometimes you need the destination to be good too.
It's very
and
true.
I get that.
Yeah. Well, that's even implied in the movie too.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I thought the first one was okay. I was like, I left it. I was like, I was entertained, you know.
Right.
And I heard a lot of bad things about the second one, so I didn't see it. But then I found out it was playing today at 2:30. I was like, well, I have 3 hours to kill, so whatever. So yeah, I watched it. I liked the first hour a lot. I thought it was cool.
Right.
But past that, I was like, God. I actually started leaving towards like, as they were like doing that last
the battle.
Like, not even the battle. Where they're like reading the suicide note or whatever at the end.
Oh,
not
yeah.
Spoilers.
Okay.
Yeah, I just ruined the movie.
I started walking out.
I was like, I made a gag noise. I was like, okay, I can't. This is awful. But
right. They could have, yeah. I don't know.
I get that it's a long book that's hard to adapt to
it
a
is.
Movie.
It really is. Yeah. But
it's like trying to make a movie about the Bible.
I know a lot of people were talking shit. I've seen it. And like, I have some friends that were saying some stuff. And I was like, it's wacky. It's a wacky book. You know what I mean? Like, everyone forgets how wacky the book is. Because like, there's even... Okay. I always bring this up. But there's a part where Eddie, I think it is. Eddie, yeah.
Which Eddie, one's he?
The one that's like... afraid of germs and his mom,
the nerdy kid,
yeah,
he's got the fat mom,
yeah. So he's walking by the house on Niebolt Street, right? And he sees this leper, just like in the movie, but the leper isn't really trying to attack him or anything. He's like, hey, kid, hey, got any money? And he's like, no, leave me alone. And the guy's like, hey, I'll suck your dick, kid. Give me a fucking quarter. I'll suck your dick. And he's like, what the fuck are you talking about? And he's like, fuck it. I'll suck your dick for free, kid. And then so he's
interesting.
Like, so he runs home and he's like scared. And then he's like thinking about how creepy that was.
Yeah.
So then the next time he goes to the house on Niebolt Street, he's like under the porch. Cause that's like when that's how you enter the house in the book. And, he sees something under the porch and it's like this fucking nasty, disgusting leper with like corpse.
Yeah.
And then he's like, starts moving around and he's like, Eddie, I'll suck your dick. And he's like, and that's pretty wacky. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
But it's scary also.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Definitely.
And in a Stephen King was probably like fucked up.
Coked. That makes me think of that part where maybe it was his character, but one of the fucked up characters is driving a car and picks him up. I was like, okay. I think that's where I kind of checked out.
Oh,
like,
really?
Oh, my God. Are you kidding me? This little monster is driving a car.
It gets weird.
Both of its eyes were all cloudy and, like, wonky. I was like, come on. All right, that's it. I'm out.
Right.
Yeah. I liked it being a crab at the end, though. That was cool.
Yeah.
It looked cool.
It gets super weird.
Very CGI. Mm. Yeah.
That's what... It's sometimes you're just gonna get a big CGI battle.
Yeah. These days,
and
that's how every movie has to end.
Yeah,
big CGI finale.
In the book, it's like an astroplane battle. They do it like
really,
you know, it's like otherworldly in their minds. Like,
yeah,
yeah, it was pretty weird.
I need to read the book because most people I've talked to said the book. Well, everyone always says the book is better, but
well, you could like even with what happened. Let's just say somebody described what happened in the movie to you, but you didn't see it with your own eyes.
Yeah.
The way that you would put it together in your own head would probably be like way cooler.
Yeah, you have to use your imagination to fill the gaps.
Right.
And it's better than any CGI.
And you're just like,
yeah.
It's glorious.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That is the biggest thing about books that I think, books being translated into movies is you're literally trusting one person's imagination to take control over the narrative and, the story.
I felt that way with, there's one scene. Have you ever watched Ready Player One?
Mm-mm. Heard it was
ever,
cool.
Have you ever read the book?
No.
So
is that Stephen King too?
No, that's not Stephen King. It's
who is that? Another big
Ernest Cline, maybe? Oh no, okay. I don't know. I'm gonna cut that if that's wrong.
Fair.
I can't remember.
Yeah.
Anyways, it's a book about like how in the future it's like so overpopulated that it sucks just like living day to day, because like there's places that are like trailer parks except for they just stack them on each other, so there's these big towers and then they put stairs on them.
Okay,
so then like all it's just way overpopulated.
Sounds like a lot of housing in like India or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. And everyone plays this game, this virtual reality game, to escape. And it's all connected. Every person that gets on, they're in this
shared universe.
Yeah. So that's what the game is about. Well, there's like a couple of scenes that Steven Spielberg directed that movie. So the translation from what I saw in my mind to what was on the screen was like, oh, that's cool. But the way I saw it was like way bigger.
Yeah.
Way bigger and better.
Yeah.
Because it was like a scene on a planet where like every person in the Oasis, it was called the Oasis, every person that had a ship showed up in the Oasis. So it's like literally every person that owns this game or whatever in their ships surrounding this planet. And then when in the movie, it was just like ground troops. So it was like people on the ground.
Yeah.
So I saw it in my mind as like this planet and just ships just fucking huddled all around it. You know what I mean? Disappointing.
I can imagine. Yeah.
But it's still a great movie and it's still an awesome book.
I need to see it because I know the Iron Giant is in it, right? Yes. For a second.
Yes.
I'm obsessed with that movie.
So that book is like an ode to all of pop culture. He tried to write a book that combined everything. It's about a society that's obsessed with old school pop culture, so they name drop everything.
That's cool.
Yeah.
See, for that reason alone, I would probably enjoy it.
Right.
Yeah.
And he like drives the DeLorean.
That's
sick.
Yeah. That's dope. I'd be into that.
Yeah. It's been fun.
It has.
I did the one with the with We Came as Romans, and I don't think they were understanding how chill it is.
Yeah.
So I was like, "Yeah, you want to do a nerd? You just have to talk about some nerdy stuff, like what you're into." And Andy was like, "Well, I only am into like graphic design," and I'm like, "You don't have to." You just talk about pop culture, things you like, you know, we could just bullshit. And he was like, I just don't know how long I could talk about like nerdy stuff that I like.
Yeah.
And I'm like, we're just going to talk.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I feel you.
Yeah. So.
Those dudes are the bomb, though.
Yeah, those bomb dudes are really nice. Really nice. Really cool.
Yeah.
I left my card at that place. Tomcats West.
Oh, is that?
Fort Worth.
Dude, that place is sick.
Yeah. I left my
card
there.
We played there probably 6 or 7 years ago.
Yeah.
And they had the best house sound guy, I think, ever. I think that's what they're known for. That dude used to tour or something. He's like a big sound guy. Now it's like his spot. But yeah.
Well, Landon, it's been nice catching up.
It's been very great.
I think it would be a good time to call it.
For sure. You're the man.
You're the man, dude. You're the man.
You gotta kiss the mic. Yeah. There you go. That's how you should sign off every.
Everyone has to kiss the mic.
All right. You got some touring coming up that you could.
No, like, we're done.
Done
for the year. After this, we record the next record in, I think, February or March, and then after that, it'll probably just be a waiting game until
fall.
The fall. Yeah.
Fall.
It's usually how
2020.
That goes. Which is cool. I need time off.
Well, thanks, Landon, for having a talk. I got you that shirt. Sport it.
Love the shirt.
Sport it.
I'll wear it.
And I hope the album turns out great.
We'll see. I hope so, too.
Hell yeah.
My future depends on it, so.
All right. See you guys later.
Take care.
Later, nerds. But you just keep moving so fast.